All right, welcome to the Grizzled Survivor Show. And today we're going to be going over some paperwork that came from a Rocky Flats right to know meeting for people that live in the area where Rocky Flats used to be. But before we get into that, I do have to do kind of an extended intro this week because you may be viewing this video on two different channels. If you're viewing this on the Grizzled Survivor channel, it's going to be much along the lines of what you have come to expect from the channel. This is just kind of an unscripted viewing of this paperwork. You know, we're just going to kind of go off the cuff. I'm going to kind of read it and analyze it kind of live. If you're watching this on the newly created Vidocq.pro channel, just know that this is not really the format that is going to be on the channel very often. The videos on the Vidocq.pro channel are definitely going to be more scripted and much more controlled. But here on the Grizzled Survivor Show, hi, Roach. We get stuff like this cat jumping up here and stuff like that. And goodbye, Roach. So, you know, just know that this is not how the videos on the Vidocq Pro channel normally are. But you can expect a lot of crossover since I'm going to be doing both channels. You can expect a lot of crossover. Especially stuff that's relevant to both channels, even if it is slightly less professional, such as today. But let's get into the meat of the video today. Get this paperwork out. I don't really want to reveal who gave that to me, so we're going to throw that over there. Okay, so this is the first page here, and it's for the Alliance for Nuclear Accountability. And it's a national network of organizations working to address issues of nuclear weapons production and waste cleanup. And it's got a bunch of partners here in the middle from all over the country. But let's kind of read their mission statement here. For more than seven decades, the United States government has designed, produced, and tested nuclear weapons under a veil of secrecy, leaving behind a legacy of contamination and waste. As we know, we've come across some of these areas. Despite compelling evidence of the risks to workers and communities, funding for cleanup continues to take a backseat to funding for ongoing weapons production activities. As residents of communities downwind and downstream from U.S. nuclear weapons facilities, we work for government accountability and protection of our fundamental rights to health, safety, and environmental quality and due process. They advocate for government policies that make human safety and environmental protection a priority, a commitment by the federal government to pay the full cost of cleanup and waste disposal, stabilization and isolation of nuclear waste points at their origin, full compliance with federal, state, and environmental laws, meaningful citizen participation in site licensing, monitoring, and environmental protection programs, and an end to wasteful spending on nuclear weapons development programs. And then here on the back, this is of interest to us here, on the Grizzled Survivor Show, it has a map of all of the sites that need to kind of be cleaned up here, and there are a lot of them, and some of them are not outside the realm of us to visit on the show eventually, so this is definitely good material for us. The back page here kind of just talks more about the Alliance for Nuclear Accountability and what they stand for, cleanup of weapons facilities, adequate funding for remediation and waste management, no new nuclear weapons, which, you know, that's kind of a murky issue with today's politics, accelerated dismantlement of stockpiled warheads and bombs, full disclosure of toxic and radioactive pollution from research, testing, and production, compensation for sickness and death caused by the contamination, transparencies in all activities of the government, tough penalties for contractors that violate health and safety or environmental laws, and protections of the rights of whistleblowers. More than 70 years of mismanagement, lack of accountability, and poor maintenance at research, testing, and production facilities, along with careless and short-sighted waste disposal practices, has created serious risk to workers, neighboring communities, and the environment. Little progress has been made on cleanup, storage, and disposal of radioactive and hazardous waste. Often, waste are cast aside using antiquated methods, polluting surrounding land, water, and air. Effective remedies will take decades and cost more than $300 billion. Some sites where cleanup is supposedly completed remain so contaminated that public access must be restricted. Which, as we know, if you've ever looked at the East Ural radioactive trace in Russia, that whole place is just off limits to humans simply because the cleanup was, you know, so unsuccessful there. The Department of Energy seeks to replace existing laws and legally binding cleanup agreements with schemes that allow it to leave more contamination behind. Research, development, and production of warheads and weapons components threaten to trigger a return to nuclear testing. Modernization of U.S. weapons and production facilities compels other nations to modernize their stockpiles, triggering a 21st century nuclear arms race. Over the next 3 decades, the U.S. plans to spend more than $1.2 trillion to modernize the nuclear arsenal from the ground up. New production facilities, new warheads, and new delivery systems. So what they're saying there is, you know, we're triggering another, basically another Cold War. And, you know, we deal with a lot of post-apocalyptic scenarios here on the Grizzled Survivor Show. And so, you know, that's definitely stuff that kind of fuels the age, the interest in the material that I present in the age that we live in. Let's go on to this next piece of paper here. 10 reasons the Rocky Flats National Wildlife Refuge must remain closed to the public. And before I get into this, you know, I just talked about the East Ural radiological trace, and that is in Russia, and it's from the Mayak reactor in Chelyabinsk. And, you know, that is so polluted that they just simply don't allow people to go there. So this is a model that is followed in other countries to not allow people onto these sites. You know, my personal opinion is with the growth of Denver, you know, there's people looking to exploit ignorant people that don't understand that the area is contaminated. You know, let's make it a park so it's more appealing for people to live here. You know, you can look on my Instagram for pictures of Stanley Lake, and that is a beautiful area, but it's also highly contaminated. But let's go over these 10 reasons, and then on the back it looks like there's some maps. Plutonium's long-term danger. Plutonium-239, the principal contaminant in Rocky Flats, has a half-life of 24,110 years. It remains radioactive for 500,000 years. The plutonium remaining in the environment poses a permanent problem. Lethal quality of plutonium. The radiation emitted by plutonium cannot penetrate skin, but tiny particles inhaled or otherwise taken into the body will lodge somewhere within and continually irradiate the surrounding cells for the rest of one's life, and it can cause cancer or some other ailment. It's also hazardous in very small amounts, which is 0.3. Columbia University showed in 1997 that inhaling a single particle of plutonium may cause harm and possibly prove fatal. In a 2006 study by the National Academy of Sciences concluded that any exposure to ionizing radiation is particularly harmful. This information is ignored by any who say Rocky Flats Wildlife Refuge is safe. Plutonium is not stable in the environment. The EPA and the CDPHE claim that there is no pathway by which plutonium left in the soil at Rocky Flats can reach human subjects. But in 1996, ecologist Sean Smallwood showed that 18 species of burrowing animals present at Rocky Flats dig down to as much as 16 feet and constantly bring buried plutonium to the surface. You know, so moles, prairie dogs, anything that burrows is going to, you know, dig this up. The next point is that the cleanup was inadequate. In 1995, the single most widely supported cleanup recommendation for the public called for the eventual cleanup to average background radiation levels from global fallout, with initial cleanup to go as far in the direction as current technology allows, turning the site into a research lab for the development of technology to do better. But none of that happened. Instead, the official cleanup allowed a quantity of plutonium in the top 3 feet of soil up to 1,250 times the average background, with much more allowed at a depth of 3 to 6 feet, which is, you know, people dig that deep in their yard to build a fence, you know. What drove the cleanup is point number six. A secret deal was made with Congress that put a ceiling on what could be spent and a set date for its completion. Appeals from the public for a better cleanup were rejected. Of the $7 billion allotted to close the site in 2006, no more than $473 million, about 7%, could be spent on the remediation of the environment. The cleanup contractor received $560 million for his work. Local people rejected both the cleanup and recreation at the wildlife refuge. Of the parties that commented on the final Rocky Flats cleanup agreement adopted in June 2003, 85.6% rejected the plan as inadequate, due mainly to plutonium being left in the environment. 81% of those who commented on plans to open the wildlife refuge to the public opposed the idea. The public was ignored. Data about environmental crime at Rocky Flats was never reviewed. So the FBI raided the plant in 1989 to collect evidence of environmental law breaking at the site. 65 cartons of documents from this investigation remain sealed in the Denver Federal Courthouse. They were never examined by any of the pertinent parties, and that's how that went. Danger to the most vulnerable. The risk-based cleanup done at Rocky Flats was calculated to protect a wildlife refuge worker, a physically active adult in good health, not the very young, very old, or the infirm. The human child is most vulnerable to plutonium because a child is known to, you know, just put their mouth on everything, and they're down close to the ground, and they're always kicking up dirt. So, you know, they are definitely still at risk to the plutonium there. And the last is the genetic effects of plutonium exposure. So in 2000, a study, Dietard Tots, said that that the genetic effects of radiation exposure on a given species of wildlife may not show up till generations later. So, you know, what that's arguing is we might not see the harmful effects yet, but give it a couple years and we may. And this was prepared by Leroy Moore. Leroy Moore, a PhD, the Rocky Mountain Peace and Justice Center. And you can go to this website here, rockyflatsnuclearguardianship.org. And I'll put the link in the description there. But that's certainly a good site. Here, let's zoom in on it here real fast. I want to make sure we get it in the shot. So that's the site you can go to there. And on the back here, we kind of have an exposure map. So up here is Rocky Flats. And you can see that it goes as far down as 72nd Avenue and, you know, Wadsworth's over here. I mean, that's an area where people live, but even further up here, you know, Denver Boulder Turnpike's right by all this radiation. And here is the current Superfund site, along with the actual, like, contaminated area and trails and everything in the area. So, and it remains on the Superfund list of the most contaminated sites in the country, and the route for the Rocky Mountain Greenway Trail traverses the refuge. So, you know, they're trying to build a trail like the ones we walk on right there in the refuge. This is how you can contact Congress to keep Rocky Flats closed. And once again, we have that website, rockyflatsnuclearguardianship.org. You can also go here to actionnetwork.org/letters/keeprockyflatsclosedforever. And here's a list of your Congress people you can call, you know, to tell them to keep this area closed and not to build houses and stuff and stir up all this radiation. Keep it open for the wasteland mutants like me that love exploring that stuff. And not, you know, the general public who doesn't necessarily know. This last piece of paper here, this very yellow piece of paper, is just a group of contacts for the meeting and everything. So the website here that you need to be aware of is rockyflatsrighttoknow.org. It's your right to know. And most of the contact information here doesn't really have much to do. It's kind of just the agenda, you know, the minutes of the meeting, so to speak. They do have meetings, it looks like, just about every month here. Except for August, we're giving it a break. But the next meeting after this video will come out is going to be on Tuesday, July 17th. They're having an NEPA lawsuit witness testimony at the courthouse. And then they're also having a Greenway Trail meeting. So these people are very active and committed to keeping Rocky Flats closed. So I'm going to leave this on the screen while we talk about our last little bit here. Thank you for joining me here. This is, you know, part of the Grizzled Survivor channel. We're going to be doing more serious videos like this. I do have a long backlog of urban exploration videos. I'm just waiting for the right time to put them up. I'm letting you guys all digest Cherokee Station there before we move on to Suncor. And we learned some interesting facts pertinent to the more serious side of the show there, too. And on the Vidocq.pro side, I want to thank you for joining us for this, you know, thrown together video where, you know, we just kind of put this together pretty quick. But I do want to thank you for joining us here on this. And, you know, be aware that the overall stuff on this channel is going to be a lot more well-produced and a lot more professional. But this is kind of a crossover video between two channels, so you got stuck with more of the Grizzled Survivor style of doing things here. But thank you for watching. You know, call your Congress people, go to these websites, help these people out. And if you're on the Grizzled Survivor channel, I will see you again in the wastelands of Denver and, you know, really anywhere. And I will show you that you don't need to live in a post-apocalyptic world to see a post-apocalyptic environment. And if you're on the Vidocq.pro channel, thank you for watching as well. And be prepared for some hard-hitting information and, you know, how you can help with these issues and how you can protect yourself as well. Thank you so much for watching.